පැර කුම් යුගයක් නැවතත් අර බව නිජ භූමිතලේ ලංකා. Good morning, fellow Shri Cubs and Shri Lions members. I hope you're all ready for a very special session of Shri Lions Online Summer Camp. So, without much further ado, Diniti Nangi, over to you.
Hello and welcome everyone to the 18th session of Shri Lions Online Summer Camp. Before I start, I want to warmly welcome the newcomers to join us this morning. But before we move on,
let's all stand in an attention for a minute of silence to honor our national heroes.
Kicked off, and then after this we're going to go ahead into the awards for our previous Shri Cubs Shri Lions Online Summer Camp session. So now, without much further ado, I'm gonna answer a very popular question, a question that many people have decided to ask: who are Shri Lions and what have they done? And this question is going to be answered in the form of a small video that we put together.
Yeah, you can be the greatest, you can be the best, you can be the King Kong banging on your chest, you can beat the world, you can beat the war, you can talk the guy go banging on his door. You can throw your hands up, you can beat the clock, yeah. You can move a mountain, you can break rocks. You can be a master, don't wait for luck. Dedicate yourself and you can find yourself.
Standing in the Hall of Fame,
yeah.
And the world's gonna know your name,
yeah.
Cause you burn with the brightest flame,
yeah.
And the world's gonna know.
You can run the mile, you can walk straight through hell with a smile.
You could be the hero, you could get the gold, breaking all the records they thought never could be broke.
Yeah, do it for your people, do it for your pride. And you're never gonna know if you never even try.
Do it for your country, do it for your name, cause there's gonna be a day when you're
standing in the Hall of Fame,
yeah.
And the world's gonna know your name.
Politicians be preachers, yeah. Be believers, be leaders, be astronauts, be champions, be truth seekers.
Cubs, who are we?
Yes. Shri Cubs started in 20th September 2019.
Yes, Natuki. It was a small gathering of 20 to 30 kids. And that was so successful, we decided to do it every month. Hence, Shri Cubs monthly gatherings came to existence, and it was a place Sri Lankan kids could come and develop their skills. Don't forget the Shri Lions Sports Academy, where Sri Lankan kids could go and learn new sports like netball and rugby and get fit. But sadly, the light of these events, the world was shut down. But I simply know that Shree Cubs were there to bring light in the darkness by a series of online events. We had the first ever online Sinhal Aurudu folk songs and acting competition in the UAE. What's more, we also had the first ever online Vesak decorations and Vesak Bhaktigi competition in Dubai. I think I'm forgetting something.
Yes, of course. Shree Cubs had the Quran competition for the Muslim community.
Oh yes, thank you, Anif. And along with these events, we have gotten the support and gained the interest of over 230 plus families. How cool is that?
And there's something much cooler than that, Vihindi. We have given over 7,500 dirhams to the winners of these tournaments.
And that leads straight to the Shree Lions online summer camp. Could you tell everyone a few of the things we learned, Kiara?
Fitness, athletics, art and craft, public speaking, Zumba, singing and so many more.
Spot on, Kiara. And remember
to get ready, because Shree Lions will be doing many more fun activities in the future.
Roar loud, roar proud. Shree Lions.
Who are we?
Wasn't that an incredible story on how Shree Lions has grown? We're just a one-year-old club and we've done so many beautiful things. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I will be putting you all on mute for the time being. And everyone, do not worry, you will get your opportunity to speak. And I would like to introduce you to the comparing team for today's session. It's going to be Diniti Randana, Sande Vanuradha, Himash Netmini, and myself. And we were all trained and led by our very own coach, Mahesh Rosairo. Shall we give a round of applause to all of these fellow compeers? Now I would like to hand it over to Himash Anangi to proceed and explain how the event will go.
We'll be giving a 15-minute open Q&A session where most of you can ask your questions. And also, you all will be muted throughout the session until the open Q&A session.
Thank you very much, Himash Anangi. So now we have prepared for a question that I'm sure very few people would be willing to ask. It is, who is Deshibandhu Roshan Mahanam? And for that, we have also prepared a short video, short explanatory video.
The gentleman we're going to talk about today is none other than Deshibandhu Roshan Mahanama, son of Mrs. Swarna Mahanama and Dr. Upali Mahanama, born in 31st May 1966 in Colombo. He played a significant role in winning the 1996 World Cup in the name of Sri Lanka. Did you know that he is the first man to have stood as a match referee in a day-night Test match in the history of Test cricket? He was the 36th Test captain for Sri Lanka and he scored over 4 Test centuries and 4 ODI centuries, and he also broke the world record by scoring over 576 runs. Following his retirement from international cricket in 1999, Roshan Mahanama made the transition into becoming an International Cricket Council match referee. On 21st October 2014, during ODI series between New Zealand and South Africa, Roshan Mahanama entered the elite group of match referees who have officiated 200 plus matches. Not only he is a talented sportsman, but a noble-hearted man. He had built a primary school for Sri Lankan youngsters a couple of years back, named the Roshan Mahanama Primary School. I have just given a brief insight into the life of National Honour Roshan Mahanama, and I am sure you all can understand why he had earned the title Deshe Bandhu. One so powerful it can be held by 150 living Sri Lankans. He has done a lot for the country and he has done a lot in the name of cricket.
Wow, what an amazing video about Deshe Bandhu Roshan Mahanama.
Good morning to all of you. I hope all of you can hear me loud and clear. First of all, let me thank all the youngsters for the fine introduction. And I'm flattered about that. But before I proceed further, let me start my speech by paying a tribute to my late father. He was my hero, mentor. All of you must be wondering why I would want to do that. When I told my father a few years ago that I don't mind standing in front of 100,000 people and playing a game of cricket, but when it comes to giving a speech or talking to a group of people, I'm quite uncomfortable. And he said, son, that's your obligation and you need to do it. But you can start your speech by using the following phrase. I must confess that I'm at ease at the crease than saying my piece on occasions like these. And he said, I'm set to bat. At the outset, I must tell all of you that I was approached by the Sri Lions president, Kalum, and I was not in a position to say no to him. I know it's midday or past midday for us here in Sri Lanka, and I had to sacrifice more or less half a day, but despite my busy schedule, I accepted the invitation as I always feel that I have an obligation towards the younger generation to share my experiences. Therefore, I will be sharing my real life personal experiences and the challenges that I had to face to achieve my goals, my ambitions as a player, captain, ICC match referee, son, father, a grandfather. In my opinion, that is the best, rather than talking about others. Since our focus is on these youngsters, I just thought at the outset I must say that whether it is in sports or in the business world today, or any field of activity for that matter, we need winners and not quitters. When I saw some of those faces earlier on, my mind goes back to when I represented my school as a cricketer. Even at that stage, there were no shortcuts to perform well. I remember how hard I had to work to improve my own game, to rise from an average cricketer and to be among the top players schools in Sri Lanka. So I want all of you to clearly remember that success in life never comes easy. It needs hard work, commitment, dedication, discipline, and also the ability to accept failure and move forward. All of you youngsters should always keep that in mind. I want to leave a thought behind again for these youngsters, as the focus is on these kids. A winner is not one who never fails, but one who never quits. I firmly believe that it is not whether someone is educated or not that matters. For me, it is the upbringing that matters. And in my view, that is very, very important. Parents and teachers can impart education to a child, but what is more important is to inculcate good values and to encourage these kids to be a good human being at all times. At the end of the day, what is important, again from my view, is to be a good human being, irrespective of what you have or will achieve in life. People will not look up to you for what you have achieved in life. They will look up to you for who you are. I must mention, I know most of you live in the UAE, but your roots are from Sri Lanka. So I would like to give you an example. Last year or year before last, quite a lot of people were calling me to find out whether the chief of staff to the president, Dr. Mahanama, is a relative of mine, as he was caught accepting a bribe at a five-star hotel car park. I do not watch news. I do not follow any news, especially local news, as I feel it's demotivating. So I didn't know what was going on. And I was wondering why people were trying to speak to me to find out about this Dr. Mahanama. Let me tell you that if anyone is connected to politics, he or she cannot be a relative of mine in the first place. I have no respect for politicians or anyone connected to politics, as they are supposed to be leaders and they do not behave in that manner. I just thought I'll use that as an example. And also, I don't know how many of you know, not that long ago, look at the doctor who recently decided to rob the general hospital. I have seen some of the worst acts committed by people who have had a good educational background. So all of you must remember that these are good examples for you to focus on value instead of money. I just thought I had to mention that to the youngsters, and I have thought to myself, whenever I get an opportunity to speak to a group of youngsters, whether they are in Sri Lanka or overseas, I need to get that message across, because we live in a world where people are losing focus on values, honesty, integrity, so on and so forth. The most influential people in my life, my parents, my first coach, Mr. Mendes, my teachers, even my wife, and those who taught me cricket, which became my profession, are my heroes and my role models. You know why? All of them, more importantly, have coached me the art of life. And I'm ever so grateful to all of them. For me personally, I will not compromise on honesty, integrity, values, discipline, loyalty, and friendship. And for me, I put money last. Just think for yourself, if you put money first, then you will compromise on all the other values that I just spoke about. And also keep in mind, above all, what is important is to be a good human being. And I just want to emphasize that for the benefit of all the boys and girls. Do not forget that I played in an era where there was no money and match fixing was at its best. But I can proudly say I never fell for any trap. I come from a humble background. I never thought that I will be involved in close to 600 international matches. The greatest honor for me is working for the International Cricket Council, which is the governing body of the game that I love so passionately. You know why? That's because I feel that they have recognized my honesty and integrity, and working for the ICC was the best thing that happened to me. I also would like remind the youngsters, respect is something that you should earn and not demand. It is your good qualities, and if you are a good human being, you will definitely earn respect. And just keep in mind, it's certainly not because people have power or money. People who have power and money, they do not earn that respect. Most of the time, they do demand respect. For me, I have lived 2/3 of my life, and I want to encourage all of you to focus on what I just mentioned. As from my point of view, it is important to leave behind a better place for the future generations, irrespective of where you live in the world. At this stage, a profound thought in cricketing parlance comes to my mind. For when the great scorer comes to write your name, he writes not whether you won or lost, but how you played the game. So always remember, at the end of the day, what is important is how you played the game. My mind goes back to when I represented my school as a cricketer. Even at that stage, there were no shortcuts to perform well. I can remember how hard I had to work to improve my own game, to rise from an average cricketer and to be among the top players in school. So I want all of you to clearly remember that success in life never comes easy. It needs hard work, commitment, dedication, discipline, and the ability to accept failure and move forward. I want to leave behind a thought again for the benefit of these youngsters. A winner is not one who never fails, but one who never quits. Always remember that you're ambassadors of your school, club, or the country. Whenever we leave the shores of Sri Lanka, from my point of view, we are ambassadors of our country. So we have to behave in a manner that do not bring disrespect to our country, school, club, or whichever organization we represent. All of us are quick enough to find fault, maybe with our country, maybe with our school, maybe with our club, or even the organization that you're involved in. But always think and be grateful for what has been given, what has been given to you. Once you have been awarded the school colors, club colors, or even the national cap, it is forever, and you should not do anything that will bring disrespect to your school, club, or the country. And I need to mention that to all the youngsters, that you are ambassadors of your school, club, or country. You must keep in mind that if you have become prominent figures, you have to always think twice before your every move. Therefore, as I mentioned earlier, you have to always focus on honesty, integrity, and values. Further, all of you must maintain discipline and obey and respect team rules at all times. When I say team rules, again, it can be a school, can be a club, or whomever you are representing. It's important that you follow the rules or the guidelines. For me, it can be in a team sport or in the corporate world, or in terms of people being involved in different professionals. Teamwork is paramount, and people do not realize the importance of it. I have always been a team man and have put the team course ahead of any personal achievements. If you want to be successful, there are no shortcuts. It is only your commitment, dedication, hard work, and by making sacrifices that you will make you a successful person, or you will be successful. Must work on improving your knowledge, should always try to develop your skills, and I must emphasize that you should persevere and never ever give up when things are not going your way. The easiest thing is to give up, but remind yourself that you should never give up. And I also encourage youngsters to have mentors or people whom they can trust, rely on to share your success story, or if you're going through a difficult period in life. It can be your mother, father, friend, uncle, auntie, but always have someone whom you can trust to go and confide. That's very, very important. Also, all of you must work hard and focus on developing these qualities, then going behind people to get benefits. As unfortunately, we see at times today generations wanting things on a platter. And I know the parents also try to encourage the kids to take shortcuts. Never ever do that. I can afford to tell you that because I have gone a step further than most of you, because I'm a grandfather of two. Very few people in this world walk the talk. But for me, the former cricketer and the current Prime Minister of Pakistan, Imran Khan, is one of them. He says in general, why I wanted to mention this, is that he says in general, people who have been successful are people who have failed, but they have analyzed, corrected their mistakes, and they have come back stronger. So boys and girls, you are bound to make mistakes in life. That's not the end of the world. Please go and analyze, see where you need to work on more to correct the mistake and come back stronger. Even when you have been successful, while you celebrate, we learn every day. So it's very important that you analyze and see how you can improve your game if you have been successful. But if you have failed, make sure not to give up, but to focus on what went wrong and to see how you can correct it and come back stronger. This reminds me of a great statement made by the legendary boxer Muhammad Ali when he said, "I hated every minute of training, but I said, don't quit, suffer now and live the rest of your life as a champion." And when we look back, yes, there were hard times for us, went through challenges, but this reminds me the statement that at the end of the day, you can enjoy and be happy and also live life as a champion. I think I should share some of my experiences as a father, and I can certainly afford to advise the parents who might be part of this session today. And as I mentioned earlier, that's purely because I have gone a step further and I've got two grandkids. Further, I will use this opportunity to advise the coaches as well. First, I will focus on the parents very briefly. Parents should get the kids to focus on their studies as well as a sport. When I told my three kids at home, I'm outnumbered, outvoted, because I'm surrounded by girls, ladies. And when I told my three daughters that it is important that they do a sport. My youngest daughter came home and said, "Tata, I can't stay out in the sun." And I said, "If you can't stay out in the sun, go and do an indoor sport. There are so many others where you can choose from, but it is important that you do a sport, because sport teaches life skills." And I'll give you an example. This daughter of mine, my youngest daughter Ruinya, started doing some board games, and one day she comes back home with a long face, and I started laughing, and she said, "It's not a laughing matter, I lost today." I said, "This is exactly what I want you to learn from sport. It is quite easy to handle success, but it is very difficult to handle when things do not go your way. So please try to encourage your kids to take up a sport. Should not exert pressure on your children, but guide and motivate them to work towards achieving their goals and show the correct pathway to reach them." My three daughters, I'm talking about the Sri Lankan education system, all of them failed the scholarship exam. I told them when they were going for the scholarship exam, "Just do it for you to get some experience and understanding of doing a government exam." I never sent them for classes. I know people here in Sri Lanka, they do send them for grade 5 scholarship exam classes. In a way, for some people that's necessary. But in general, I think you should not exert pressure. My three daughters, I'm not saying because they have done well in their chosen field. Like I mentioned earlier, I will be talking about me and my family. I thought that was the best way to get a message across. My eldest daughter, who hates studies, we never thought that she will get through her O-levels. We never thought that she will get through her A-levels. She got through her O-levels, she got through her A-levels. I had told the three daughters, that they have to be qualified in whatever way they could. The advice was, because I said, don't look at your mother and think that life is going to be easy. There might be hard times, and you should be able to stand on your own feet. So she decided to do SIMA, that Chartered Institute of Management Accounts. She was slow pace, went up to the top SIMA. She found a partner, and then she decided that she wanted to get married. And my only advice for her was to finish whatever she had started. And she failed the top SIMA. She got pregnant and she couldn't handle it. And I know at home there were messages flying around to say, "Why do I have to do that? I'm not going to work, and I'm not one of those nagging fathers." I had made a request, and it is up to her to fulfill. And I think she thought, "I need to do that." And when the baby was born, she got the help of the mother and the sister. And she thought she'll give one more go at doing the top SIMA. And she ended up being Sri Lanka's number one and world number 5. Why I'm saying that is, I told the same thing to her. I said, "Puda, it's not because you got through. You always say that your nangis are brainier than you. But you don't get anything in life unless you work hard." And also, parents should remember that you have to encourage kids to live their dream, work towards their dream, and also if they're going through difficult periods, to handle those difficult periods, not to go and find fault with the teachers, the masters. I'll give you another example. My second daughter is a qualified doctor. She's come back to Sri Lanka, and when she was overseas, she was there with a group of Sri Lankans. When I told her, when she told me that she wants to go and she was going to study overseas, I said, "You're going there with a purpose. You need to focus and finish your studies." I know some of the kids, when they are let loose, they were going out and so on, but I knew that she should handle herself in a manner that she was not going to neglect her studies. So that was the advice that I gave, but some of the fellow students were making it hard for her. They were having dirt, beer bottles, liquor bottles outside her room for her to get into trouble. She was crying, wife was panicking, obviously when a child is going through a difficult period. But I said, calm down. These are things that they have to learn and go through, because at the end of the day, when they achieve something, they will look back and they will be happy that they had to go through these situations. I'm sure during the Q&A, you all will ask me some questions. There were similar incidents that I had to go through. I used that to convey that message to my daughter. And she became, she backstopped in anatomy, she backstopped in forensics, she backstopped in the fourth year. My youngest daughter, again, she did a degree in mathematics and honors. Why I'm saying this is they're not bright. And we didn't push them, but we encouraged them to do well in whatever field that they chose. And as parents, I think we should not entertain criticism of teachers, coaches, but encourage kids to work harder and always encourage kids to control only the controllable. There are things which we can't control and we should not focus on them. What you can control is yourself and your kids. Parents are there only to support and guide and not to take the kids towards their goals. I hope you don't mind me mentioning this. I just thought, as I'm focusing on a young group of kids, that I need to get this message across to the parents. The coaches, teachers also, if there are any, just keep in mind, do not look at the status of the parents in selecting or giving opportunities to kids. That is not your concern. You should look at the students and look at their talent. And especially if you're dealing with young kids, you should be able to spot talent very early and guide these students. Do not look at shortcuts. Coaches, teachers, I would like to emphasize to prove that you're a good coach or a good teacher, and you should never ask for favors from anyone. Again, for example, recently someone called me and he was trying to look at buying a car, and I asked him, why are you so keen to go and get this car? And he was pushing me to try and get a better deal and so on through some of my friends. And in our part of the world, it's whom you know, how you know. And he said, my son is at Royal College. This is for one of their coaches. And I said, yes, you can help him, but what he's doing is not right, because he will always be under obligation to that parent. So make sure that you do not ask for favors from anyone. Yes, you have other friends. There are other ways in life we need to help one another. But if you're in a group and if you have that power of coaching, teaching, you need to make sure that you don't be under obligation to anyone. For me, that's why I'm not under obligation to anyone apart from the game of cricket. And I think that's very, very important. Do not do favors, like I said, to the kids as well. Some of them help them to carry bags and help them to do their job. No, that is not your job as a coach or a teacher. Do not do favors to the players, the students. I'm focusing on the sporting side of things. Because again, for example, one of my friends decided to take the son for coaching classes to my first coach, Nelson Mendes. So he was happily going. Apparently the wife had selected the date and sent the son with the father. So father was carrying the bag, went up to my first coach and asked, sir, I'm here, what we should do from now onwards. Then he had looked at the father and said, who came for practices? He said, no, sir, my wife had spoken to you and you had wanted us to come at a particular time. He had said, I thought you had come for practices, because if the son's coming for practices, the son needs to carry the bag, go to the entrance, get the son to carry the bag and walk back. It applies to parents, it applies to coaches, teachers as well. If someone's not well, sick or humanitarian grounds, yes, you can do it. But otherwise, we need to encourage these kids to do do the right thing. Those great coaches, teachers, teach us the need to behave ethically. So to do that, they need to behave ethically as well. Over a lifetime, teachers who behave without ethical constraint will not extract the full potential from those entrusted to their care. And I just thought I need to get that across. Finally, the children of today are the citizens of tomorrow. They have to play an important role in our communities. Thus, a good education combined with other facets which accompany a school sporting career is imperative to develop good civic minded citizens, and I need to emphasize that kids must have implicit faith in themselves, set realistic goals, and strive to achieve them through sheer discipline and hard work. Remember, destiny is not a matter of chance, it is a matter of choice. It is not a thing to wait for, it is a thing to be achieved. Whilst wishing all of you continued success, I want to leave behind a profound thought or a statement made by one of the greatest leaders the world has ever seen, the former president of South Africa, Nelson Mandela. He said, "Don't judge me by my successes. Judge me by how many times I fell down and got back up again." May all of you be blessed. Teruvan Saranai.
Well, what a wonderful speech, and it was so inspirational. So those were some very precious words, and I think we'll never forget those words said by Mr. Roshan Mahanama. So everyone, let's take a quick break before we start the Q&A session. So let's take a sip of water, walk around for a little while. Thank you.
Sri Lanka, high score of 119 not out. Hasn't been a happy tour for him today. At the same time, beautiful stroke through the covers. Full toss, he took full toll of it, placement and timing to perfection.
Well, this might be Roshan Mahanama's day. Perhaps he's going to turn things around for himself. Perhaps he will show us a little bit of class that we know he's capable of. Oh, he's hit that in the air. This is going to be our two. No, it's not. Oh, what a magnificent catch to finish the match. That is unbelievable. Mahanama in the deep has gone full length to his right, and he has pulled off one of the best outfield catches you will ever see.
I've got 35 for three. Is this a dramatic start or what? Don't even have seven overs bowled as yet, and three top order batsmen back in the pavilion. Roshan Mahanama, the new man in. Straight away a bit of turn, but nicely played by Mahanama, waited for it and placed it beautifully.
My beloved coach, Mr. Nelson Mendes, and his family. Principal of Nalanda College, Mr. Tilak Watueva.
That is gone. It's a wonderful catch there, and Spearman hit that very well, and that's Roshan Mahanama at his best. He took off that with right, and New Zealand have lost the early wicket, and Craig Spearman really...
And out for two, half a minute to start this second wicket. Very hard to distract. Second wicket, very good reflexes indeed. Nice hard with on the ball. A good series against the New Zealanders.
the full class first time. Well supported by Roshan Mahanama. The partnership has now grown to 548. And congratulations from the Indian bowlers. 2 full days out in the middle. It's never been done before. Highest partnership in Test cricket. 1,093 balls space between the two of them.
All right, so everybody, welcome back. And I just need to say, isn't that amazing? Deshbandhu Roshan Mahanama, he was the most respected, he was the best fielder for the Sri Lanka national team. And he had the longest consecutive partnership ever. So for that, I'm really proud to have you here, sir. And now, without further ado, I know most of you are waiting to get your questions answered. And I'll hand it over to Himasha Nangi to ask the first one.
Yes, thank you, Arya. This question is coming from the Sri Lions president, Mr. Callum Sujit.
Thank you very much, Callum, for putting me in a spot. I think being sportsman, we've been told what goes on tour stays on tour. Likewise, what happens at home stays at home, especially in a washroom. But for the benefit of the youngsters, I will share that experience. It was not a very pleasant experience, but prior to falling down and hurting myself, yes, as a kid, my passion was to play the game. That's all what I saw, unlike you, the younger generation. In our days, we used to play on the streets, mainly cricket, and even when you're at home, either you'll be throwing a ball onto the ball and taking catches, or while you're in the shower as well, you'll be playing your strokes, trying to take a single, and so on. And for me, that day, yes, I thought I was involved in a game of cricket with my friends, enjoying the moment. Unfortunately, slipped and fell and hurt my cheekbone. And I still remember my mother, my father was working. I mentioned before, we come from a humble background. So my mother had to take me to doctor, which was walking distance, but I still remember she had to carry me. She was a teacher, and she had come back home after school and took me to the doctors. Here I was bleeding. I think I would have been quite brave as well. I would have cried up to an extent, and after that, yes, I was in pain, but thought I'll go to the doctors and get him to attend to the wound. Yes, the doctor did his best, but what has happened is, if you look at the cut, the scar is there. Later on in life, some of the other doctors said that the doctor who did or put the stitches have not done it properly, but they can cut it open and do it again. And by that time, I had started to play for my school, and I just saw, what is the point? People recognize me for that scar as well. Why should I make any sort of changes or a makeover? So I just thought I'll let it be like that. That has become a trademark, but certainly not a pleasant moment. When I look back now, all those injuries, the wounds and so on, was because of the sport that I love. And I can proudly say that I was able to fulfill my dream.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for sharing that with us. Over to you, Sadhav Mali.
Thank you, Himasha. Now, this question comes from Kendi Sihansa, Parashi Adhikari, and Mahima Navodi, some of our youngsters, Sri Lanka Online Summer Camp members, were asking a similar question. So we thought to put them together. What does it feel like to be a cricketer? What inspired you to play as a cricketer? And what age did you start playing cricket?
I must first say that I was taught and I was reminded at a very, very early stage of my sporting career, cricketing career, that whatever I do on a plane, I need to keep it there and come back. So yes, proud to do something in my small way for my country, play for my country. That's a game that I love so passionately. Even as a kid, I had the passion for the game. There were various reasons. My father had played the game. My elder brother obviously was already playing cricket. My maternal uncles were sporting personalities. I still remember when I used to go to my grandparents' place. We didn't have TV in the good old days, but we used to listen to BBC radio. That's how I followed at a very, very early stage of my life, to follow the Ashes, those matches, listening to commentary on BBC radio. So everyone those days was focused on cricket. I know my maternal uncles ended up playing rugby for Sri Lanka as well. One of them captained the Sri Lanka rugby team. Yes, I do love rugby as well, but I ended up playing the sport further, getting into Nalanda. My father was an old boy. Up to now, four generations have gone to Nalanda. If my grandson goes to Nalanda next year, hopefully that will be the fifth generation, because only school is not even 100 years, and for five generations to go to Nalanda, I feel it's an achievement. So we are keeping our fingers crossed. But even when I was at Nalanda, what we heard was the names of Bandula Warnapura, who was the national test captain of Sri Lanka, or the Sri Lanka cricket team. We had people like Lalit Kaluperuma, Jayanta Seniviratna, Anura Ranasinghe, Leslie Narangoda, so on and so forth. And I just thought, yes, I need to play for my school first. I need to follow some of these cricketing personalities. And from there, to see whether I can progress. I develop a passion towards the sport at a very early stage, for obvious reasons that I mentioned. Something again comes to my mind. My brother used to go for private coaching classes to one of my father's friends. My father was working at Unilever, and this coach, a former Sri Lanka opening batsman, ACM Lafir, was having coaching classes. So because of their friendship, my father decided to send my brother to the Nomads cricket ground. Youngsters might not know, but the parents might know where they are. Now they built the Nelum Pakuna. That is where the ground was. And my brother is 3 years older than me, so he started. And my father thought that he can't keep me at home. He needs to take me there as well. And I think the coach, from what I can remember or from what I've heard, was not keen to have me because I'm playful and I was very small. But my father insisted that, I think maybe because they were not in a position to keep me quiet at home, so the best was to send me for those classes. And those were the early days. That's how I got into playing as well.
Thank you. But there's still one more question from Shazek Romi, another one of our Sri Lanka summer camp members. When did you start the habit of kissing the handle of the cricket bat before you faced the ball, and what was the reason for this habit?
Yes, I think I will answer the question. Then I'm not going to break it down into stages, but your friend will obviously get the answer to the question. For me,
Thank you, sir, for sharing that with us. Truly, it's a blessing to have you here with us. I would like to hand over the mic to Kemitaya.
Thank you, Himashanangi. So I have two last questions that I would very happily like to ask you. First of all, I would like to ask, after the retirement of most other players, we could see that they have started building multiple businesses and they're very busy with them. But for you, Deshbandhu Roshan Mahanama, we can see you're very busy with multiple charities. So what made you want to do these kinds of things? What inspired you?
I think I was brought up in a culture where we were taught to spare a thought to the less fortunate ones. I know not only me, there are other prominent personalities, including a few fellow cricketers. They do support different charities or support people. And for me as well, I don't like to publicize. I generally stay under the radar. People got to know that I was into this as well when I built the second school in a remote village called Veherathanda, which is about 25 kilometers from Kabidigola. But that too, when we went for the opening, I had two of my colleagues, Chaminda Vas and Upul Chandana, and it was on Chaminda's Facebook page, and that's how it went out. I'm involved in about 8 charities. That again is because of the upbringing, that because of the fact that at an early stage, where we were like I mentioned before, we were taught to spare a thought to the needy or less fortunate ones. And I still remember how my father used to put things together. After he passed away just over 3 years ago, we got to know he has built temples, he has built bridges, which I didn't know, certain things which I knew. Even after tsunami, we got together and raised funds through friends and family and did about 65 projects. No one knows that was initiated by my father, and we executed and we did it professionally. And when I was approached, I'm the brand ambassador for Hema's Outreach Foundation. Because you asked that question, I will give you some details. Even today, before this program, I was talking to somebody to try and get him to help, to build another. We have built 58 preschools throughout the country. I'm involved in Mituro, that's a prevention of addiction. Then SOS Children's Villages, RA Foundation, which is where that's an organization where we look into the welfare of disabled soldiers and families of soldiers who died. Then I'm also involved with the IIT Center of Excellence for Kids with Disability. Then involved with the Sri Lanka Stroke Association, Sri Lanka Kidney Patients Society, and even during COVID, I got together with a group of doctors, then my dear friend Chaminda Vas, and we were able to give essential items, goods, to more than 3,500 families. It reached about 10,000 families, and I will use this opportunity to thank Callum and all the Sri Lions for making a contribution to that project, which would not have been possible if not for the generous donations from groups like the Sri Lions. So it's just the upbringing, and I must say that I've got one of my father's brothers. He's the only one who's living out of his family now, and he dedicated his entire life to social service. And together with him, we have embarked on another small project in Madhabachir. And I think the school that we are trying to build, which is going to be the 59th preschool, is in Damana. So for me, it gives me a lot of satisfaction. I've seen things being done by my parents' side, mainly my father, my uncle, and I know that it is important for me to do that. And I must mention, I have not even built houses for my kids, but I will always come forward to do something for the society. I think people have this thing in their minds that if you are to do charity, it is only by giving money. I don't agree with that. There are various ways of contributing to society or doing charity. It's not only by giving money, it's time, energy, knowledge, and networking. When I say networking, if you can get people to help towards a cause, then it's very important. I have had so many people who are coming forward to support, and I must tell you, I'm not so active on social media now. I don't believe in publicizing this, because doing something for the community is not for publicity, but to get that satisfaction. But like I mentioned, I'm the CSR brand ambassador for Hema's Outreach Foundation, and my Facebook is handled by Hema's, one of the boys, and it's monitored by my youngest daughter. It's purely because sometimes we deal with other people's money. To be transparent, we need to do that, but it's certainly not for me to get any mileage or anything. It's just to show that whatever people contribute, it goes to worthwhile projects.
Thank you very much, Deshabandhu Roshan Mahanama. In fact, you just answered both of my questions in one go. So that was really great. Thank you very much, sir. So now, that will be all for the pre-sent questions to Mr. Roshan Mahanama. And now we're going to be having an open forum for two questions, two lucky questions. So I humbly request you all, if you have a question that you would like to ask, please put one of these icons above. And then, so I kindly request you all. And yes, I can see Mr. Don has a question. Over to you, Mr. John. Don.
Yes. Mr. Mahanama, respected sir, we are very pleased to see you, and it's a great opportunity for us to meet you online. Since I was educated in the Trinity College, I had the privilege of watching you playing live at Asgiriya. As a youngster, we really enjoyed seeing you all playing at Asgiriya. And I have three questions. Now, at your era, you were the best all-rounder in the Sri Lankan team, and you were always fielding in the covers region because you were so fast, your reactions were so quick. What made you to be a fielder in the covers region? It your choice or the selector's choice for that?
Can I answer that, and then we'll go to the other two? Otherwise, I might not really give you the answer that you're looking for. I will correct you and rephrase as well. Yes, when I was playing junior cricket, I was an all-rounder. But then, because I was captaining all the age groups, I had to sacrifice my bowling because I didn't know when to take myself off, and I didn't know when to bring myself back. So, being the leader, it's very important. You know when to go off and when to come on. So I focused heavily on my batting and fielding because I thought at the time, now of course people have to be good in all three departments, but at the time I just thought that you had to be good in at least two departments, and fielding was one. Batting I was doing reasonably well. Yes, I was working hard on my batting, but I had to work even harder on my fielding because I knew otherwise there would have been a void, and if I don't start, or if I don't keep scoring, then it was only a matter of time that I will be taken out of the team. And when it came to the national team, I know there were times when I was going through, like anyone, you know, we go through bad phases. I stayed in the team because of my fielding. And you ask why I fielded there? Maybe because at junior level I was a captain of my team. So generally the captain stays in the inner circle, and I was mainly at school at mid-off or slips. Then when I joined the national team, we had people like Roy Dyers, who was an excellent fielder, but it was a team where they were bringing in youngsters as well. So we were strong, young, we had energy, and I went into covers. And Don, if you really look back, I have always been a team man. If you really look at my statistics, I'm not saying it's me, but I don't think it'll justify my talent, because my best years were when I played for Nalanda, because I batted at three. But for Sri Lanka, no excuses. I think I lived my dream, and I'm happy about it, because for the first time ever in my life, I opened in a test match. Mm-hmm. Then I used to bat down the order. If you really look at the people who switch over, people like Mark or even Sachin, they used to open in the shorter version and bat down in the low version. For me, it's the other way around, because you play more one-day cricket and in a one-day match, even if you nick one, sometimes you don't have fielders, you get away. But in test match cricket, it is different. So I did it happily, and there was a time whenever they asked me to do something, I happily did. So I must say, I'm just in the process of collecting some of my, because when we played, TV quality was very poor, or the television coverage, in the process of collecting some videos just to have something for me. So I do have clips of from fielding, from slip cover to deep extra cover to mid wicket as well. That was something that I had to do when there was a requirement.
Right. And the other thing is that I would like to go back to my history. When I was in college, when I was trying to become a cricketer, I was a reserve. During that time only, Murali was also playing for St. Anthony's. And I can still remember one match when we played in police grounds. Myself and Murali, we used to be reserves, and we were at the scoreboard scoring. So at that time, we were reserves. And later, Murali became to be a world-class cricketer, whereas I couldn't continue my cricketing career. So I would like to ask you, if you were not a cricketer, who would have been like in your career?
Say my apologies, good.
Don, I don't think I can think of anything else, because from the age of about 7-8, I was playing cricket, and I must be one of those lucky ones who was able to live my dreams. So my focus was heavily on sports, and at a particular time I had to switch over to cricket. If I didn't play cricket, I would have looked at a sports like rugby, but as you would know, rugby is not so popular at Nalanda, and Nalanda Ananda is more popular for cricket. And I would have been a sportsman, and that's why I told when I delivered my speech before, it's important for the parents also to allow their kids to live their dream, and also for them to find out where the talent is. But I can't really think of anything else. I am sure I would have been a sportsman, even though it was not lucrative at the time. And I would have, if I did not get into the national team when I was 19, then I would have looked at other options. So I didn't have to look at other options, continued with what I wanted to do.
Two more quick ones. Since you liked your cricketing career, who was the most challenging bowler for you during your span of your cricketing life, and which was the most challenging cricket ground you played during your cricketing career?
I think as a bowler, I would always say the most difficult bowler that I had to face was Wasim Akram. No two words about it. Wasim was devastating. He had a lot of control. He was able to bring the ball in, get the ball to go out, the short one which comes towards you or goes the other way, or the Yorker. So there's no two words about that. But in terms of a ground, I will not single out one, but I would say the grounds in Australia early days was challenging to us, because in the good old days, now of course they do have a boundary rope, but previously in Australia it was the fence, can be a picket fence or the fence. Yeah. And boundaries were, the fence that was right down the oval. And coming from Sri Lanka, we were not exposed to grounds where we could throw that far. And in Australia, they had something called a relay throw. That two guys, there's one guy halfway throws to him and then he puts it back to the keeper. So we were not used to it, and we are generally small made people. We are not strong. We were not exposed to any strength training and so on those days. So that was quite challenging, and we had not learned the art of sliding, skidding, but which we adapted to as we kept on. And I think we're able to get through those difficult times.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. And it was a great opportunity. And thank you, Kemit Putha, for giving me the opportunity to talk to this legendary cricketer. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Don, for your very insightful questions. And I'm incredibly sorry, everybody, but that will be... And I'm incredibly sorry, everyone, but that will be all the questions for now. All of the public ones and the pre-sent ones. But the thing is, Deshbandhu Roshan Mahanama, I still have another pack full of questions. I have another 23 questions that have been sent to me from very eager fans of yours. So we really want you to come for one more session with us. All right, sir?
Kemit Putha, will do. Definitely, obviously, like I mentioned before, I was not in a position to say no to your father. Obviously, you know that. Just two things in a nutshell. I just want to get it across to the youth, right? I think it's my responsibility. I know we are running out of time. I'll quickly say that the youngsters should always try and park positive thoughts. It can be an examination. It can be a game of cricket, any other sport that you're planning to play, because we have something called a subconscious mind, which never sleeps. So always feed positive thinking. I kept this document in front of me. There was a document that was given to me by my father when I was playing under 17 cricket, when I was captaining the team. It is called Psycho-Cybernetics, a study that has been done in the US, how the subconscious mind works. So I would like to tell all these kids and encourage coaches, teachers, parents, if you're going for an exam, because I have two of my daughters who are still studying, they'll be psyched up for the exam. I have told them not to focus beyond the exam. Just be in the process and park or feed positive thinking as much as you can. And also for the youngsters, I must encourage that you have to have a mentor, someone whom you can trust and discuss openly. Don't ever give up. Even recently, I know there was something that we had to face as a family. And even recently, I just saw a youth in Singapore had decided to end his life. So make sure that you never give up. Keep working hard. And there is a solution for every problem. And also, every kid has a talent. And the responsibility of the elders is to allow that kid to harness that talent. And also, one last thing, there were two personalities. This is mainly for the parents. One is Dr. Indrajit Kumar Swami, who was the former governor of the Sri Lanka and Sri Lanka rugby player. And the other one is the current CEO of Hemas, a female. Both of them have reached to the top of their chosen field, and they say, the female is Kasturi. Kasturi played netball for Sri Lanka, and now she's the first female who has been nominated as the CEO of a big organization. And both Kasturi and Dr. Indrajit Kumar Swami has said that what helped them to go through challenges, those difficult periods, is their connection with sports.
Thank you, Mr. Roshan Mahanama. Now I'd like to hand the mic to the president of Sri Lions, Mr. Kalam Sujit.
Dr. Sangaratne Niyojane Karamin, me avasthavedi wedawasaya karana Bambalapitiya Vajraram vasi sitina Mahanaga handurangin avasarai. Good afternoon, everyone. National Roshan Mahanama, sir. It is an honor and privilege to have you here today. You thought an insightful ideas was exactly what we and our children very much needed at this time. Mr. Roshan Mahanama, you're a true legend. you are my childhood hero, and I grow up with you playing the game which we all love. But not only that, things you are doing for the nature and the community, eventually you become my role model. As a president of Sri Lions, I must tell you this, it's great honor and prestige just to have you. We look forward to your support in the future, advice. So we wish you all the very best, good luck, and may Triple Gem bless you. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you for those amazing words, Mr. Kalam Sujit. Over to you, Himasha.
Thank you, Sadhav Malli. Now I would like to hand over the mic to the General Secretary of the Sri Lions Club, Mr. Suren Rajamohan. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for all of you who joined us. It's been a wonderful opportunity, especially the kids who did a wonderful job. And thank you, Mahesh, taking care of the team, to preparing, and the rest of the guys who are here. Excellent. Thank you for your time, for being a part of the Sri Lions meet. And a big, big, big thank you to Deshabandhu Mr. Roshan Mahanama. Such an honor, such a privilege to have you with us. Thank you so much for your kind words, your words of wisdom. We are really blessed, we're truly blessed. Half the kids who are here, they were not even born when you were playing. But for them to see you, to hear from you, you are a true legend. And this day, they will really remember, they will treasure. And the words of wisdom you just shared with us, that's excellent even for us. Highlighting hard work, commitment, discipline. And you pointed out ability to accept failure. That's one of the key things which we need to accept and to learn. Excellent, sir. We had a wonderful time and we wish you all the best. You have always made Sri Lanka proud on and off the field. You have carried our flag, made us proud, and you are a true legend. And you are definitely an icon in our eyes, and definitely when cricket look back in time and definitely see you as an icon. We wish you all the best, all the support that you do to people and the charity that you don't even share with many. But we wish you all the best. Thank you for making us proud. Thank you for making Sri Lanka proud. Thank you for spending your time with us and making Sri Lions proud. And this day we will always remember and cherish. We have recorded this session, and it's going to be one of the best event that we have ever hosted. For that, we are so grateful. Thank you very much, sir. We wish you all the best. Good luck to you, sir. Thank you.
Suren and Kimit, let me finally, I know we are going to conclude, but I just want to leave a statement to all of you, kids, mothers, fathers, grandfathers, and this is a statement that the great Nelson Mandela said, first, be honest with yourself.
Once again, like so many other people over here are doing, I would like to thank you. And I'm talking to all of my fellow Sri Cubs now. Everyone, let's unmute our mics and give Deshabandhu Roshan Mahanama a great big thank you. Just first go to our Lions Roars, and then we'll go ahead with the thank yous. All right, in 3, 2, 1. Who are we?
Sri Lions!
One more time, okay. 3, 2, 1. Who are we?
Sri Lions!
And now a huge thank you. All right, 3, 2, 1. Thank you very much, Deshabandhu Roshan Mahanama, for coming.
Thank
and sharing
you. Thank
your
you.
Wonderful experiences with us.
Thank you.
And my dear Sri Cubs members, we will be having a Zumba session also. I'll give you all a 10-minute break so you can go. You can have a glass of water and change into your Zumba outfits.
Thank you. Well done.
Roar loud, roar proud. Sri Lions.